So you want to see what little baby orchids look like? The little seedlings we can see on here, you can see them with the naked eye. If you look through the microscope and you look to see just how small the seeds are and how small the embryos of these seeds are, somehow they're not green and they don't even look like plants. But this is kind of the way most orchids start out their lives. This was actually a conundrum that Darwin posed. How is it that orchids that produce so many seeds are so often rare? He calculated that if every seed grew into a plant, then the great-grandchildren of one orchid would cover the earth in a continuous green carpet. But yet they're rare. If you roll it around, you can see how tiny the little seeds are as they stick to the sides. What I've worked on mostly is, why the heck do so few of those seeds actually make it to adulthood? And a lot of that seems to have to do with the fungus that they need, because they can only grow where the right fungus is and where there's enough of the right fungus. All orchids need fungi, yes. Now, the orchid that you bought from the grocery store probably didn't come with a fungus. If it were a species of an orchid growing in nature, it would need a fungus to grow. For orchid seeds to germinate, to start to grow and to grow into new plants, they absolutely need fungi in order to grow. So the fungus grows into orchid roots and forms these tight coils inside the root cells. And the orchid is actually able to digest those coils of fungus and to absorb the nutrients from them. If you looked at the root, I mean, you see there's this root hasn't been washed. Usually we wash it before we do it. But you can see that there are some sections that are sort of more yellowed and just sort of look like they've got something going on there. And my bet is that we would find concentrations of the orchid mycorrhizal fungus in these sort of yellower sections in here, and usually up here at the base. We identify the fungus using DNA sequencing, and there's a particular region of DNA that is the diagnostic region for identifying fungi. Almost none of the species that we find associated with orchids have a name. They're not named, they're not known to science at this point. They're almost all new. I think there's like 150,000 fungi that are identified, and they think there's like 1.5 million. But orchids are everywhere too. So even though orchids are really rare, there's a lot of them. It's arguably the largest plant family on Earth. There's an estimated 25,000 to 30,000 orchid species. 10% of the world's plant species are orchids. What we're doing here is we're growing them up in preparation for looking at the genes that are expressed in these orchids and in the fungi that they associate with, and using that to understand how orchids and fungi get along, how they find each other, how they stay together, how they work together to support the orchids growing and to determine where the orchids can grow. So we're looking at basically one-to-one what genes are expressed in the fungi, what genes are expressed in the plants, and how do those work together to make this partnership between the orchids and the fungi. Orchids very much show us what's going on with the environment, because they need fungi that are growing in the soil, they need pollinators that are typically flying around. Sometimes the fungi that they need depend on trees. So you have to have the tree to have the fungus, to have the orchid. And you also have to have the pollinators. So the orchids are sort of integrating an awful lot of what is interconnected and functioning in the environment. So if something goes wrong in the environment, the orchids are often the first species that you lose. So in that sense, they're very much a bellwether of the condition of the environment.